Bro.
Hi, this is Justin Roberts, and you are listening to Three Count Thursday. Hope you enjoy.
A little bit of the bubbly.
I did it for The Rock. Give me what I want! Everyone has a price for the $1 million man.
It's about the 14 years it took me to go from undesirable to un-goddamn deniable.
Mamma mia!
Three ain't enough, now I need five. Welcome in Jim, Ryan, Matt, Tim, and Intern Mark.
They think they got the answers. I change the question.
What's up, everybody? Three Count Thursday. We are with you. We are not live, but special times call for special circumstances, and that's exactly what we're doing. We're sitting here Tuesday night after WrestleMania, the fallout from the Raw After Mania, and everything that happened over the past 3 days in the world of WWE, and we are glad to bring you this, a WrestleMania recap. Do not worry, though you cannot see us on a camera. We are socially distant on this recording. There's only two of us in the entire show that are even in the same town. That is Ryan and myself. We are not in the same building. Most of us are not even in the same town as each other. So we take social distancing very seriously, here at Three Count Thursday. So, let's bring in, now Tim, unfortunately, is not with us this evening, but we have Ryan, we have Mark, Intern Mark, and we have Matt on the line. So guys, the first and most important question is how are you guys? Are you guys doing well? Ryan, are you doing well? I guess I forgot that not everybody can see me, and we can't. So Ryan, are you doing well?
Yeah, there we go. We're going to definitely have to make sure we pass off to one another with, like, a dedicated format here. You know, Three Count Thursday, always the professionals. We ironed all of this out before we went live.
Obviously.
Or live to tape, whatever we're doing here. Jim, I'm doing well. I am as essential as I can be. I am in my own little studio. I have a little bar next to me, so probably going to crack into some sort of booze here while I'm doing this. I don't know. I've got a little bit of Jameson, a little Cappy Morgan.
Wait,
I don't know what I'm going to do.
Is that
I'm going to have a drink.
Is that a shoot, Ryan? You legit have alcohol?
That's a shoot.
Shit.
That's a shoot. I'll take a picture. I'll put it up on Patreon.
Wow.
Shoot.
That's
sauce it.
That's a surprise. I have not known you to drink very often, but I mean, given all the circumstances, you are more than welcome to partake in a beverage or two. Matt, how are you doing?
No complaints at this point. It is my week in terms of our office and the rotation to be in the actual office as opposed to working from home. So it's kind of weird to be out on the roads and see like 14 cars the whole way there, but is what it is. Here we are. Social distancing, Three Count Thursday, the pants optional episode of the show. Mine are already off, so don't know about you guys.
I'll be fine.
I mean, I've been at home, with the exception of like walking around my neighborhood. I've been in my house. Tomorrow will be for 3 weeks straight. So I have worn pants less time in the last 3 weeks than I've worn pants. And when I say pants, I mean like gym shorts. I'm as casually dressed as can possibly be throughout all of this, which if you know me, that's my daily attire anyway. Intern Mark, how are you? It has been a long time since we have talked to you. How are you doing over there at Hottenstein Estates?
Hey, things are good. I'm doing well. I miss all you guys. But I'm chugging along. Given the circumstances, we're doing pretty good. Pretty good.
Now, I do want to give one programming update. I have added two sound bites to the soundboard. One of them is one Ryan sent me like easily 2 months ago, and I never got around to do it. So that is this guy right here.
I'm mega hard.
That is John Cena rapping that he is mega hard.
I'm mega hard.
And you guys can hear those, right?
Yes.
Good. Thank God. And then this gem from the movie Tommy Boy.
What'd you do?
I feel like those are both will fit our show both tonight and moving forward very, very well. So I did want to add that. I don't even really know. Excuse me. I don't even know like where to begin, because like this was just such a weird year for Mania, obviously, with everything going on. got a tickle in my throat. Don't worry. I'm fine. But let's just start overall, like going into it and coming out of it. Like, how did you guys like think this was going to go? And did the whole presentation of the weekend, and we'll dig into the weekend, did it, did they surprise you? Were you disappointed? Whatever. We'll start with you, Ryan.
Jim, I'm so glad that you've chosen to start with me. I going into it, I was signed on. I'm like, there's no way I'm going to really enjoy myself watching this. It's not going to be for me. Some people are going to love it. Some people aren't. But really at the end, Jim, I was really, really surprised at how many like loops and twists and turns it really took. And I ended up really, really enjoying myself. And I'll probably watch Tiger King again.
Dude, I feel like we may have to do some sort of something on Tiger King ourselves, just because, I mean, the craziness of that, it was nuts in and of itself. I mean, if you have not watched Tiger King, the majority of you who are hearing our voices, you have the time, you have the Netflix, just do it. Please just do it.
But honestly, the same thing applied to WrestleMania.
Awesome.
I didn't think I was going to love it. Ended up really enjoying it.
Matt, how about you? Like from pre-Mania to post-Mania, just kind of general thoughts.
I'm glad you clarified, because you initially said, how did the presentation of the weekend go? And I thought we were talking about the weekend, the performing artist who gave us the song that introed us in here. So now that I know we're talking about the actual presentation of Mania, I don't know. I think of all of us, it was weird going in. Like, you guys were all bummed, and I was like kind of okay with what was happening. I felt like I was the optimistic WWE fan going into the weekend, which was kind of odd for me, because that's never the case. And I think that everything just kind of lived up to what it was. It was just a nice escape for all of us wrestling fans. So I don't think I could have necessarily been too disappointed, even with any finishes, because it couldn't have been worse than anything we've seen in the past. So it was just kind of nice to get that kind of live sport atmosphere for those two nights. And it didn't really matter to me what happened in the end, except for one match, which did go the way I wanted to. So that's where we ended up.
Yeah. Intern Mark, from pre-Mania, post-Mania, you know, what, where were you at?
Well, I'll tell you what. First of all, the that song by The Weeknd, I can't think of the name of it. But if you watch TikTok, that little clip of that audio is on there quite a bit with people dancing.
It's Blinding Lights, and that thing has been playing
Blinding Lights
in my head. I mean, just for days.
80s feel
just
to
for
it.
Days and weeks, yeah.
Yeah. Very 80s. I love it. Every time I hear it, even for wrestling, I think of the people dancing on TikTok. Maybe we could do that one of these shows.
Oh, Jesus. I'll leave that up to one of you guys. If you guys want to take the lead on the TikToking, I'm not even sure if we have a TikTok page for the show.
We can make one.
Nor at our age and weight. I don't know if we might exceed the weight limit for TikTok. I'm not 100% sure how that works, but
I mean, Jack Black is that TikTok sensation, so I feel like we could get away with it.
Oh, that's fair.
We'd be the biggest thing on TikTok.
That is 100% true.
For sure. But anyway, for the weekend, the actual Saturday, Sunday weekend, not the performing artist. I went in with very low expectations. I had very low excitement, but I was pleasantly surprised, and I was all in by Sunday night. Hashtag all in. I enjoyed it very much.
It was weird, like for me, and yeah, I think you hit the nail pretty squarely on the head there, Matt, because you know, most of the time I'm the, you know, me and Tim, who's again not joining us tonight, you know, we're the ones that are always kind of like, you know, maybe just give this a shot, maybe just try and see this out, you know, on anything that like the WWE does. And here was the thing, the last time we were live on the air it'll be 4 weeks from this Thursday. That was the last time Ryan was sitting here at my right, and you know, I think I'd even said at that point, I think we were discussing, because the WWE was still committing to, we're gonna have WrestleMania in some form or fashion, we're not canceling. And you know, I think I was like, they probably should have just canceled, you know. And even once we knew it was in the PC and everything was in the PC and Florida was locked down, and I was like, well, I mean, if it's on, I'm going to watch it. And that was the stance I had taken. I wasn't like super jazzed up about it, 'cause I'm like, it is weird. You know, SmackDown and Raw and NXT and AEW, all of it, all these shows, they're doing their best. And I commend every person that's putting on the shows. It wasn't that. But like, it's just, it's different. It's weird. It's not something we're accustomed to. So I'm like, they're going to give us, you know, 16 matches or whatever it ended up being of this, how is that going to work? So I was under the mindset of, I'm going to watch it, but I wasn't crazy excited. I mean, as it started to build and I watched some old manias in the days leading up to it, I tried to make it feel as WrestleMania-ish as possible. And then the last... Whoa, I'm getting some sort of crazy echo from somebody. Who changed something? Who did something? Holy crap. Who's... And this is the beauty of social distancing. The SmackDown before Mania, the closing segment with The Fiend and John Cena and the way it ended, that really kind of hooked me in. And coming out of Mania, I couldn't have been more happy about the 2 days, because for two nights, for 3 hours each night, I didn't think about all of this stuff. And you know, when looking at and when grading this year's WrestleMania, and we'll after we go through this, we'll give our letter grades. But like, for me, and this is just for me, when looking at this WrestleMania and this whole period of time, really, It's kind of held in a capsule all its own. So, you know, same, no different than the Raw After Mania last night. Like, I know a lot of people were like, I saw some people on Twitter going, oh, they're just giving us a tag team rematch from WrestleMania. I'm like, well, there was only so many people that are allowed in a building at a time. There's only so many people that they're traveling into Florida to do these tapings. And it's probably the majority of them are people that live in and around Orlando. So they don't have to travel as many people in. For me, I just kind of hold all of this stuff in its own special world. And, it's for me, the way I look at it, the way I grade it, the way I view a lot of the matches is basically how does this make me feel? And hopefully when we come out on the other side of this, and we will eventually, if you look, you know, across the pond, everywhere else that was ahead of us on what's going on here, is slowly beginning to improve. So we're going to come out on the other side. My hope is for me and for hopefully for a lot of people is we can maybe look at things a little bit differently, both in wrestling and the world in general, and just kind of how does this make me feel, you know, and can I escape into this and not be as, I don't know, I don't want to use the word smart, but in a way it's kind of what I'm saying, because I kind of let the wrestling take over for a couple of days, and man, did it feel good.
Yeah, Jim, I think that's something that a lot of us are doing, especially those that, like, you know, have a hand in independent wrestling. What we were doing, on the weekends, is that we actually talked about that. I think recording our prediction show, how, like, I miss independent wrestling. I miss even the dumb things, like it'll be a long time before I, like, bitch about starting late at an independent show.
Right.
Independent timing, we're 30 minutes late or whatever. Doctor's not here. At least we have independent wrestling. So things like that, it's going to make me really kind of cherish what I have coming back out of this. And you're right. Like, I'll be the first to admit, I wasn't watching a ton of SmackDowns and Raws heading into WrestleMania. So I wasn't fatigued on seeing the no fans. So it was a unique experience. I'm sure we're going to go over some numbers, but this proves to be a very historic WrestleMania for the WWE. I would call it a success.
Sure. Yeah. And all right, let's dig into it. I don't think we obviously need to go like match by match on the entire card, because, you know, I think it would just, we would be here forever. But, you know, for me, you know, the match, I thought the show started, you know, Saturday night started well. Kickoff match. Women's tag I thought was really good. The first one that I think of noteworthiness on the card was Becky Lynch, Shayna Baszler. Because I think if you look at the last couple of months leading up towards this event, obviously, you know, Royal Rumble and the NXT women in the Royal Rumble were very dominant. And you also had the Elimination Chamber where Shayna Baszler literally just destroyed everybody in the Women's Elimination Chamber. And it was like, okay, we're pretty sure she's going to win. Like, I just kind of reserved myself to, okay, she's the perfect one to dethrone Becky Lynch. The match itself was only 8 minutes and 30 seconds, and this, among some other ones throughout the entire weekend, felt like a very fast finish. And maybe we can kind of talk about that as a whole. But this match specifically kind of had the Bret and Piper finish from WrestleMania 8, where it was like kind of a quick reversal pin. And you know, I was very surprised. I was surprised the women's tag team titles switched. but I was surprised by this one too. And I'm still getting an echo from somebody every couple of seconds. But it was just one of those ones where I went, this really doesn't make sense. And I don't know if maybe it's because the uncertainty of what the next X number of weeks of programming will be and can look like. I read this evening that they're working on a series of tapings over the next like day or two to get us through the next, I don't know, month, 6 weeks. I didn't read exactly how long, and they were strict that, you know, they're going to change out and disinfect like ropes and turnbuckles and canvas between every match, which is good. I mean, obviously they're doing their best to, you know, keep everybody safe. So, you know, this result just really kind of surprised me. Ryan, we'll go to you.
Yeah, I was shocked at like the time of that match. I was like, wow, that's really quick. But that's also like what happened if you get caught? Like, you know, you got caught in a quick pin and the match ended. Like, I was actually okay with it once I really dissected and like let it all just play out. You know, I feel like Baszler got caught and that's how the match ended. So, you know, to have that finish after 15 minutes, I might've been a little more bummed about it, but, you know, it kind of like Lynch caught Shayna Baszler, plenty of meat left on this bone. So, 8 minutes, 30 seconds is fine. They did seem like shorter matches. Again, they kept it to 3 hours and 3 hours ish. So yeah, I'm okay with it, man. Short matches. We had 9 matches each night, I think. So yeah, I'm fine with that.
How about you, Matt?
I mean, I didn't get the result at first. I still really don't. You know, we saw Shayna just kind of go through the entire women's roster. So to see it end like that is very kind of meh. So I guess it kind of just builds for someone else to be the one to take down Becky. I just don't know who that could be with how much they build up Shayna. And if they are going to make it her down the road, I don't think Shayna's built for that kind of role. Like, I don't see her succeeding in the chase. She doesn't have that kind of sympathetic era to her. So I'm not going to say wasn't happy because I love Becky Lynch. It just confused me, and I still don't really see where they're going with it.
Before Mark gets on this response, to me the only thing that really makes a lot of sense would be if Ronda Rousey would come back, but I don't see that happening in the current state of affairs. Like, you know, is maybe WWE's hoping that that we get SummerSlam and Ronda comes back for SummerSlam and wins the title from Becky. But let's be honest, you know, SummerSlam's like 4 months out, and I know that sounds like a long time, but there's no guarantee that there's a SummerSlam like in a stadium or an arena with like a bunch of people in a crowd. And I hope there is. Like, I hope that, you know, we get through this like quicker than everybody anticipates. But, you know, we already pretty much know Money in the Bank is not going to happen in Baltimore. We pretty much know that AEW Double or Nothing is not going to happen in Las Vegas next month. You know, when you're talking about like college football, NFL, they're looking at potentially moving their season back or not having fans. That's in the fall and winter. So like SummerSlam's probably not going to be SummerSlam like we wish it was. So, you know, at some point you either have to like just kind of suspend title defenses or, you know, just roll with the punches. Cause like, yeah, I don't know. I don't know how it all makes sense. Sorry to jump in front of you there, Mark. Your thoughts on the Raw Women's title?
Jim, that's okay. You can jump in front of me. I think I pretty much agree with everybody else. I was a bit disappointed in the time. I was hoping to go a little longer, and the finish did seem rushed. And the first thing I thought of, too, was the Bret Hart-Roddy Piper finish. at WrestleMania 8, I think it was.
Yeah.
It was very similar. I was a little disappointed with the overall match, and I can't help but wonder, had this been held at the stadium and the coronavirus wasn't happening, if we'd see different results for some of these matches. I really think we would have.
Yeah, I mean, let's kind of look at that, because like, instead of kind of going match to match, and if there's a particular match maybe that that you guys want to touch on, we can do that. But like, looking down over the card, I think there are, you know, at least a handful of match, close to a handful of matches that would have gone a different result or a completely different way than with the situation that we are dealing with. This is one of them. I think Shayna wins if it's in the stadium. Obviously, Roman Reigns probably would have beaten Goldberg. Like, I think the title's moving off of Goldberg either way. We don't get a Boneyard match. We don't get a Firefly Funhouse match. We don't get a... how long was that one? 36 minute, 35 second last man standing match between Edge and Randy Orton. You know, I think Drew McIntyre still wins. We don't get what they showed on freaking Raw last night. And we'll touch on that. But those ones at least, I think are matches that are at least different or booked different or whatever. But because of the situation, you know, it kind of dictated some things. I definitely do think that the coronavirus and the empty building and the recordings and all of that, I think, played into a change with some of this show, not just from who was on it, but how some of the matches played out. Ryan? Ryan, are you muted, Ryan? Are you awake, Ryan? Earth to Ryan. He might be doing something.
A mega hard.
Matt, your thoughts on the venue and the situation kind of dictating some of what we saw and some of what happened.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely an interesting point. I mean, it was one that I thought could play a role, and then it didn't end up going in the direction that I thought. Like, I thought we would see the belt stay on Goldberg, stay on Brock, just because of the uncertainty and Vince wanting to have a big name having the belts with everything going on, to just keep drawing people in to watch on TV, since there's not going to be any live stuff for the foreseeable future here. So I don't know. Like, I definitely think Roman wins if he participates, but I was kind of surprised to see the Goldberg result. Happy that it happened, but still kind of surprised. And definitely, I think that played a role in what happened with Shayna and Becky Lynch. And, I'm sure we'll talk about it, but also played a role in what happened with Charlotte winning the belt.
Oh, right, right. For anyone that hasn't heard or hasn't seen, it's being reported now. This hasn't obviously been confirmed, but it would seem logical that Rhea Ripley has had to return to Australia, where she is from, because her work visa has expired. And once she arrives there, she'll have to go into 2-week quarantine because of international travel. Obviously, with everything going on, there is no word on when she'll be able to get another visa and return here to work. So obviously, a very unfortunate situation. We hope that she is obviously safe and healthy, but a very unfortunate situation, because we talked on our preview and in the weeks leading up, like, it's such a huge opportunity for her, a huge opportunity for NXT and the brand and the NXT women's title, and now obviously that and obviously the NXT brand with Charlotte as the champion, certainly could be doing just fine. But obviously a bump in the road for Rhea Ripley. So we obviously hope that she is okay. Any other thoughts, intern Mark? Ryan, I don't know if you're back with us. I don't know if you were muted, if you had went for a snack or something.
I'm back with this. Woo!
We were talking about the situation that is going on right now, dictating some of the booking decisions from this weekend.
I didn't even know the Jersey Shore was involved this week.
What a dick.
Yay! Now I got connected somehow. I'm sorry, my guys.
It's okay. It happens.
I think you can look at the Triple Threat ladder match and realize they made, chicken salad out of chicken shit when, The Miz couldn't show up, and how they had to piece together that. And it ended up being probably one of my favorite matches from night one. So, yeah, I mean, coronavirus sucks.
Yeah, yeah, 100%. Intern Mark, any thoughts? I you had kind of spurred the topic, so any other thoughts on the situation dictating this weekend?
Well, I really wanted to see what the pirate theme would look like in the stadium. I was disappointed in that as well. I was looking forward to that the whole year, honestly.
Yeah, and here's the thing. I know I put a tweet out that at some point I would just hope that I wish that WWE would at least show us some renderings of what the stage would have looked like. and maybe they aren't, because I have seen that WWE is heavily considering WrestleMania 38 being in Tampa. Basically giving them the mulligan based on scenario, and having it there in 2 years, obviously in Hollywood next year, 355 days from tonight, as we record. Now we can also talk about this here. Is the two night thing we'll hit on that it could potentially change, but as scheduled, 355 days from now. Maybe they're just going to wait, and they're going to redo the pirate theme. I don't know, because there was so much potential there. Obviously, I even said to my wife, and I'll give her this. She sat and watched both nights with me till about 10 o'clock, or a little before 10. I think she went before the Boneyard match, which she missed out on that one on Saturday. But between 2.5 and 3 hours each night, she stayed. Now, wasn't as keenly tuned in as I was, but she played along. So I'll give her credit, being a trooper on that one. It was obviously just a bummer. Let's talk about maybe what was. And let's put it this way, outside of the Boneyard match, because we'll talk about that in and of itself. Outside of the Boneyard match, what was your match of the night for night number one? We'll start with you, Ryan.
Night number one, match of the night, Kevin Owens, Seth Rollins, the no DQ match. Hated the false finish in the middle there. It was done. Brought it back. It up really, really a much better match after it restarted under the no DQ stipulation. So I'll go with Seth Rollins, Kevin Owens.
All right, Matt, how about you?
Yep, same exact match. I remember I messaged you guys immediately with the DQ finish, was very upset, but they redeemed themselves. And I thought that the storytelling in that one was absolutely incredible. I thought that it was important that Owens get his WrestleMania moment finally, and I think they did it in the perfect possible way.
All right, Mark, your match of the night for night number one.
Well, I'll tell you what, this might sound a little weird, but I really enjoyed the women's tag team match, which I thought it really kind of set the pace for the rest of the show. I really thoroughly enjoyed it much, much more than I thought I was going to. even though I do like all four participants, I didn't think it'd be one of my favorites, but I think it was for the night.
Yeah, no, I thought that was a real strong start. Like when Bliss's music hit, right when the show came on the air, I was like, huh, interesting choice to start. But I also think that has to do with Asuka. Like if there has been an MVP of WWE since they've gone to the empty buildings, it's Asuka. Like for every like fear and concern and rumor about like Vince doesn't understand Japanese wrestlers, and you know, and maybe every one of those concerns is valid as it pertains to Shinsuke Nakamura. But like over the past couple weeks and months, since we have seen, you know, the Asuka promos and the Kairi Sane promos, and then throughout this empty building stuff between Asuka on commentary, I think she's wrestled on every single show, main event included, apparently, from what I hear on Twitter. I don't watch main event. But, you know, she has been really carrying the product as much, if not more, than everybody else. So it was a good start. As for my match of night number one, it's a close one, but I'm giving the edge to the SmackDown Tag Team Championship Triple Threat ladder match with only three competitors. When they made the change and you know, everybody was like, how could you have a tag team match with, you know, singles competitors? It's like, look, normally, like, even if I would try to like justify it, it would still seem weird and not okay. But like, these are, and not to sound cliche, these are just, you know, unprecedented circumstances. So I was like, okay, whatever. It's a tough situation. Let's just see how the match goes. And I thought it was so good. I really did. And even the way that the match came to an end was so well done. I'm happy that Miz and Morrison are still the tag team champs, but yeah, Rollins and Owens was spectacular as well. Now let's talk about the Boneyard match, because you know, when the match was announced, I much like all of us, what's a Boneyard match? And then when Undertaker gave his promo on the last Raw before WrestleMania, it seemed pretty evident that we were not getting the Dead Man. And I'm like, oh, crap. Because, like, I was never really into, you know, American Badass Mark Calloway. I want my Undertaker with the bell and the gong and the druids and the smoke and the lightning and all of that. I don't want a guy with tobacco in his lip and a motorcycle and Limp Bizkit. So when we've kind of figured out that we were getting the biker, I was like, okay, let's just find out what a Boneyard match is. And there was no way that I would have ever envisioned this match and what they did to be as good, as great, as perfect, or, you know, any wonderful adjective you can put in here. I would have not anticipated. I loved every second of the Boneyard match, from the entrances to just, I mean, it was perfection. Like this, it was so well done. So well done. Ryan.
I'm gonna start by saying I don't need to see a lot of these matches. I'm gonna make that abundantly clear. This was as close to perfection as they could have made it, from the gong and the hearse rolling in, to then AJ Styles coming out and like spoofing the whole thing, to Metallica Jam. I don't what was it called? I don't even know what it was called. But a badass.
Oh, crap. Let me look it up. I have it right here.
Don't play it.
No, I'm not going to play it. They'll shut our shit down like it's going out of style.
Long has us wiretapped because we said the word Metallica.
Probably, yeah, no doubt. Yeah, let me just find it.
Now that we're dead.
Yeah, that's the one.
I just looked it up. So, oh my God, I was like, what is this? This is going to be another like broken Hardy compound thing, and it blew it away.
Yeah,
this was top notch. The WWE at its absolute finest, a perfect piece of entertainment to wrap up night one of WrestleMania.
Matt.
Yeah, I did not know what to expect, and going in, like, of all the matches, I think this was the one where I was like, this is going to really disappoint me, I think. And it didn't. I was on the edge of my seat. I loved every second of it. I loved the campy horror movie feel to it. As a big film guy in general, I think it's just the production of that match was flawless to me. I liked Druids. I liked AJ coming out in the coffin. Everything about this was just what they should have done. They nailed this. They knocked this one out of the park.
Yeah, how about you, Intern Mark?
I'll tell you what, I wanted more of it. I liked it so much. It was fantastic. It was like watching a movie more so than a wrestling match, but it was so good from start to finish.
Yeah, and Ryan, I'm with you. Like, I don't, you know, I saw a lot of people like, there better be one of these type of matches on every WrestleMania for the next 5 years, or, you know, WWE needs to do more of these. I'm not necessarily in that camp. Like, if it makes sense and we're still in kind of a weird situation, you know, 2 months from now or whatever, if it can make sense and you want to do something offsite, and shoot it cinematically, sure. But I don't need a Boneyard match every year. I don't need Sting and The Undertaker in a Boneyard match next year. So, like, for the people that are saying that, I mean, if that's what you want, that's fine. I don't really want that. I actually don't need another Boneyard match. you know, and again, like, if you have to do something, or if you want to because you know that it can work, then maybe you can try it, but I don't think because of the success of this, that it needs to happen. But obviously, because of the success of this, we know WWE, there's gonna be more of this. But yeah, I don't necessarily need it. But yeah, it surpassed just anything and everything that I could have thought that it would be in more. I think I ended up seeing that it was shot over, what, 8 hours, six different cameras. I think it took multiple days to set up. So, I mean, it was a legit shoot. And let's think about this, because and we'll talk about the Firefly Funhouse, which was, I think, fantastic in its own way. But both of them were, from what I understand, produced, and overseen by Jeremy Borash. Walk back 5 years, 10 years, and have somebody tell you Jeremy Borash is going to put together the two best, moments from WrestleMania 36. And, I think all of us would have probably laughed at that person out of the building. But yeah, it was, I think, the perfect close to night one of WrestleMania. Let's shift to night number two. And let's, before we jump into any specifics, to you guys, which night was better? Which did you enjoy more, night one or night two? Ryan, we'll go to you first.
Oh, man, night two for the in-ring action, although night one absolutely stole it with that barnyard, or with Barnyard, yeah, Jesus Christ. The barnyard. I'm going to say night one.
Okay. Matt.
Yeah, night one, I think overall, had more of the moments that just resonated with me.
How about you, Mark?
You know what? I'm going to go with night two just to be different. Actually, I thought night two, I enjoyed it a little bit more, but not by much. They were both very good nights and very entertaining nights.
Overall for me, I think it's night one. And if you look at if you just look at the two cards, like night two was the more stacked card. And maybe that's why that, and or maybe it's just because like I just had that like the WrestleMania high coming off of night one. I'm not taking anything away from night two, because it was really good and it gave us some really awesome moments. But yeah, overall, I think night one struck with me a little bit more. Kicking it right off, Charlotte Flair and Rhea Ripley with an absolute fantastic match to open up night two. Obviously, the surprise to me anyway of Charlotte Flair winning. Now we probably know why. I think one of the funnier takeaways from this one is just how many people, and I think we even talked about it in our group text. I know my brother like called me because I gave him my my network login. He doesn't really watch wrestling, you know, on a regular basis. This was probably the first WrestleMania he's watched, you know, in any fashion in at least a couple of years, as it was on. He calls me and he's like, so I had a real hard time telling his girlfriend. He's like, I had a really hard time telling her that I was watching wrestling and not something else during that opening match. And I think we all commented on that one. But it provided some humorous headlines. I think I saw one from a satire site that said, you know, something about like WWE fans in trouble with their wives because they've caught watching porn or something. But it was an awesome opener. Besides the Edge match, it was the longest of the night at 20:30, and I think it set a really good tone for the night. Ryan,
Jim, I'm gonna give that one like the wrestling match of the weekend. Would belong to Charlotte Flair and Rhea Ripley for me. I think that was my favorite wrestling match. In the squared circle, if you will, they got very vocal, no doubt about that. I just feel like there were moments that would have played to the crowd so well, and it would have just really, really created some great moments with fan reactions that unfortunately we're never going to know. But yeah, this was a banger of a match for sure.
Matt.
Yeah, I was kind of surprised to see it start off the night, but I think it did well to do that because it was, from like a wrestling purist standpoint, probably the best one we would see. I mean, we've all made the comments about the awkwardness of the ring being empty. And the sounds coming out, but I think that it just, for those two, I think that they were just caught up in the moment too. Like, I think they both knew how important their match was going to be, with this being such an unprecedented WrestleMania. And I think they kind of put on a hell of a show just to like say, hey, it's still wrestling. You guys can still enjoy this.
Yeah, great way to put it. Intern Mark.
Yeah, I enjoyed that match thoroughly and the build-up to it. It had a great story going into it. It was just a fantastic match. And I was okay with Charlotte taking the belt. That was fine. And also, as I think about it, just the fact that there were so many women's matches and women involved in WrestleMania this year, and 5 years ago, that wasn't necessarily the case. I mean, women's wrestling, if you really think about it, how far it came, and to have a match like that be match of the weekend is pretty incredible.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, you know, you go from last year that, you know, the women were main eventing. This year, obviously, so there was tons of women's matches on the card. Liv Morgan got the win over Natalya in the kickoff show on Sunday night. There was plenty of women's matches to go around. you know, Otis got the big win. Let's move to the last man standing match though. And I think the most common complaint I saw from this one is the length of the match. And I mean, it was a long match. There's obviously no way around the fact that this was a long match. It did seem like it drug a little bit at times. But much like the Boneyard match, much like the Firefly Funhouse match, this is the only year where you're gonna get a 36 minute last man standing match, because if you do what they did for that length of time in front of a crowd, even an arena crowd on a regular pay-per-view, it ain't gonna be pretty. Like, let's be honest, if you spend that much time away from the ring area, that crowd's turning. So to me, you know, I kind of look at the whole thing in a capsule, and if there's going to be two guys that are going to go for that long and both to the point of just absolute physical exhaustion, to where you're wondering, is he really going to throw this guy off of a trailer, which didn't happen. It's going to be Edge and Randy Orton with the story that was told. So yeah, it was a little long, but I loved it. I loved that match. I don't ever need to see that long of a last man standing match ever again. And I hope we don't, because if we do, it means we're all under quarantine again. And I don't want to be stuck in my house again for this long and even longer, 'cause we're not done yet. You know, so again, in this capsule, I love it. And man, but I tell you what, and Edge isn't the only one. Like, Drew McIntyre, Rhea Ripley, there's multiple people on this card that Kevin Owens even, that I go, man, this is such a bummer. Because, and if you guys haven't watched the WWE 24 on Edge, watch it. You absolutely need to watch it. It's phenomenal. But for being away 9 years, and you come back at WrestleMania to a 4-foot ramp in an empty building, like, it just, there has to be some degree, and Edge will never say it, even in any interviews probably, that's got to suck. It does. It has to suck. On some level, that has to suck for him. Ryan, your thoughts on the last man standing?
Jim, it is the second longest match in WrestleMania history.
Seriously?
It is the second longest match in the history of WrestleMania.
Wow.
To the last man standing match. Nope. The Iron Man.
The match. Iron Man, Bret and Shawn. Wow. Yeah, there hasn't been another match. I guess not. Damn.
WWE doesn't do long matches. Uncle Dave told us that.
That's true. He told us a lot.
This is the reason WWE doesn't, because people bitch about it.
That's true.
So the Japan crowd is used to seeing these matches 30-some minutes long, 40-some minutes long. The WWE audience is not. I felt it was a little too long for my liking. It could have ended 6-7 minutes earlier, and I'd have been fine with it. Fun match. Weird that they went with the whole, like, I'm going to choke you on the workout machine.
But, you noticed that, huh?
Yeah, everybody did. That felt a little uncomfortable. But
what'd you do?
Yeah, just a little too long for me.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. I mean, that's fair. That's fair. Matt, your thoughts on the last man standing?
Way too long, 100%. I enjoyed it, but towards the end, I was like, all right, let's wrap this up. it was just, once they got to the top of the truck, I was like, if we're not going off the truck, and I don't think we should, why are we getting up here to begin with? So at that point, I was just kind of checked out. But it was a cool match overall. I liked kind of seeing what all the different layers of the training facility have down in there, with, like, I don't know, I guess a garage where you can just build whatever you want to just throw people through, which is pretty cool. But I mean, otherwise, once we got to like minute whatever, I was like, all right, I'm done.
All right. Intern Mark.
Hello there. Same thing. It was definitely went too long. I did enjoy it, but then it drug there for a while. And honestly, hearing Orton and Edge moaning quite a bit in pain was uncomfortable at times. But other than that, it was a good match, but yeah, definitely too long.
I think Rollins and Orton had the best groans of the weekend. Not the painful groans. I think we can agree that Charlotte and Rhea had the best grunts or whatever we want to label those as for the weekend. But in terms of like pain groans, I think Rollins and Orton won the weekend there. Let's bounce ahead to I thought that with the SmackDown women's title, the Fatal Five Way, I thought that match got really good when it was down to Bayley and Lacey Evans. Because I thought for sure it was coming down to Bayley and Sasha. My brother, you know, he had texted me. He's like, this thing's definitely coming down to Bayley and Sasha. So we got a little bit of a swerve there. And then it was like, you know, it was like, are they going to switch? Is Lacey going to get the win? Okay, Sasha's definitely going to help Lacey here. And then she obviously didn't. So it was an interesting way to end it. I thought Lacey and Bayley really did a good job once it got down to those two. Ryan.
Yeah, it's kind of suspect, Jim, that you skipped over Liv Morgan beating Natalia.
I mean,
we'll
I mentioned
on.
It.
I just feel like you didn't talk about it.
I thought we don't talk pre-show matches on this show.
Yeah, but this is different. This was Natty in the pre-show.
Okay, I mean, we can talk about it.
No, it sucked. there it was. I'm really shocked Tamina didn't do better in this match. Something killing people, killer instinct. Lacey
there he is.
Really cute. Looked attractive, and Bayley won. That's my take on that. Didn't love the match.
All right, man.
I think this match had the opportunity to be one of the better matches of the night, of the weekend, and it ended up being one of the worst, in my opinion. Didn't love the finish. Didn't love. If you're not going to go with the obvious finish of Sasha versus Bayley, then you need to give us something new. And instead, we just got same old shit. And I mean, Tamina being in there just infuriated me regardless. But then we got the whole team bad thing, and then the super kick. Like, they just tried way too hard to like be clever with the match, and it all just fell flat. I would have liked to see a new championship. I hate Bayley's haircut. I hate Bayley as a heel. You know, give it to Lacey. Let Sasha have a WrestleMania moment. I mean, for God's sake, put it on Tamina if you really want to be different. But they just did nothing that they could have. Two thumbs like down.
I feel like Matt just created a soundbite we have to get, and it's just him saying same old shit.
Yeah, I might have to. I might have to dig around on the timestamp on that one, because that's pretty solid.
Like we've been back on a couple times.
Mark, your thoughts on the women's Fatal Five Way?
I'll tell you, first of all, I'm sorry if Matt's upset. Matt, I'm sorry that match upset you. You're very upset. I the match was okay. I mean, it wasn't one of my favorites, but I was okay with Bayley retaining. And honestly, they could still play out this Sasha Bayley thing for another year at the rate they're going. Tamina, I honestly am surprised she's still with the company. I don't get her. I think she had a lot of potential, but she's just a miss in my book.
Yeah, and here's the thing, like, that's why I like specified when it got down to Lacey and Bailey, I thought it got good, because the rest of it I did not enjoy. So like this was definitely, in terms of fatal five ways, like, it was definitely a non-preferred. I would have just rather it have been Lacey and Bailey with Sasha on the outside and you know, had the question of, is Sasha going to turn or isn't she? All right.
It was just originally going to be a five-way. They made it the fatal five-way when they added Tamina. That made it the fatal version.
I see what you did there.
All right, let's talk Firefly Funhouse, because this one, like, after the Boneyard match on Saturday night, I was like, oh man, like, all of a sudden this match to me, like, has like a high bar that it has to clear, because I figured, you know, they shot this off site in some, like, you know, hack ass mansion that some twisted, demented, you know, creation of Bray Wyatt and the Fiend. And it was not what I expected at all. Looking back at it from there was a tweet from somebody that I saw that it makes kind of a lot of sense why they went about it the way they did. You know, cause it was just completely different. And they kind of, it was the Fiend making John Cena relive his whole entire career. I loved Bray singing the Nikki Bella's theme song. I loved Cena coming out in the Ruthless Aggression tights with the SmackDown fist. It was so weird, and I don't even think I've like processed it all. This and probably the Boneyard match, like, I'm gonna have to go back and watch again, at least one more time, just to process everything that happened in this thing. And it was like as perfect to me, you know, the looking at it, as the Boneyard match was, but for so many completely different reasons. I absolutely loved it. You know, it looks like they were protecting Cena because, you know, he can't really afford to get hurt. He's a movie star and all of that now. And I thought the whole thing was pulled off just so extremely well. I freaking loved it. Absolutely loved it. Ryan.
Yeah, man, I was in the boat of, like, good luck following that coming out of the Boneyard match. And they swerved me real, real good. You have John Cena's music hit, and he comes out to the ring. And I was like, the fuck is this? I guess we're getting entrances.
Yeah, I was like, oh, you got to be shitting. It's just going to be a match.
And I, like, instantly got like, oh, no, this is not going to be good. But, oh my God, what a gamble the WWE took putting this match together.
Yeah.
Like, it could have just not gone over at all. But people were witty enough, and it really paid off. If you were a wrestling fan for a long time, you got to really enjoy this match because you witnessed these things happening in real time, to then be thrown back in the face of John Cena. You have to be a smart enough fan to realize, like, Bray Wyatt was singing just a quick verse of Nikki's theme song. Like, that's brilliant. And it really, really paid you. If you were a smart wrestling fan and you've watched for a while, there was a ton of, like, little things in there that just made sense to you. Beautifully told story. And fuck anybody that says the WWE doesn't tell stories, because this was the most well-told story in the past, I don't know how many years. Beautifully done. A+.
Yeah. I saw somebody tweet out Sunday night after this aired is like that match, that segment was a reward for people who are longtime fans and pay attention. Like, and I think you hit it square on the head there, Ryan, is like, if you know, and you are a longtime fan, like this match, you know, it gave you plenty to tie back to. Matt, your thoughts on the Funhouse?
I thought it was just perfect. There wasn't anything that I would change from how they did it. I've seen people say, well, they should have done this, they could have done this, and that's fine. It's just for what I wanted from that match, they really gave it to me. I mean, that they had the Fiend come out looking strong. I mean, this sets the tone for what we're going to see from the Fiend moving forward. I loved every single nod to the past of John Cena and the past to just wrestling in general. I thought that it just worked on so many different levels, and at no point, like when it started to when it finished, was I at all nervous that they were going to do the wrong thing. Like once it started, I was like, okay, they listened, they got it, we're getting retribution.
Yeah. Intern Mark.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, that Firefly Funhouse was, I call it a masterpiece. It was that good from start to finish. Fantastic. Well done. That NWO piece, boy, when that came on, I absolutely popped. It popped me big time, Jim.
Oh, dude. That was like,
so good.
Every part of it. Every part of it. I'm trying to find the, tweet it was two tweets from the New Age Insiders on Sunday night during this. One said, if you ever needed proof Bray Wyatt doesn't need titles to get his job done, you're looking at it. And then when the match is over, he said, well, the Firefly Funhouse was absolutely perfect beginning to end, and if Bray Wyatt walked away tomorrow, he's left his mark on pro wrestling. And those two tweets, I think, sum it up extremely well. Because And here was the thing. At some point with the popularity like surge of the Fiend, like it was pretty obvious that we were going to see him win a title. But I think all of us said back when the Fiend even first debuted that this is one of those characters that doesn't need one, that doesn't really ever need one. And unfortunately, like when we got it and the way he lost it, like, we can revisit how mad I was after Super Sandown. And I still hate the decision to have him lose to Goldberg. Okay. I hate it. I do. But like, that is so far in the rearview mirror now. After this build to the John Cena match and the retribution for Bray and the Fiend, and now God only knows what this character can do coming after this matchup, and after, you know, after finally avenging what happened at WrestleMania 30, like sky's the limit. But again, you don't need a title. You don't, you know, he can just continue to prey on people forever and a day. And then, I mean, at some point, cause like my brother had an interesting theory that, like, you know, if like John Cena beats him, like maybe it just, the Fiend just goes away and we just Bray Wyatt's Bray Wyatt. And eventually that we're probably going to get to a point where the Fiend does go away and Bray Wyatt's just Bray Wyatt, but there's still so much left, with the Fiend. But yeah, I agree with what you said, Matt. Like the minute the thing started, there was never any fear that somehow John was going to win at the end. Like you could tell from the moment things got awkward that this was going to be the Fiend's night.
Jim Up Rocks, who I know we've shared some stuff from them before. just has a great breakdown of the whole thing. I mean, even some subtle things that I wasn't necessarily picking up on, like the very beginning, you know, in the dark room with Vince McMahon, like that's the moment before he was even created, because Vince essentially created John Cena himself. Like I didn't really get that. I got the whole like ruthless aggression part and like wanting to impress Vince McMahon, but like the dark room without anything, like it's so brilliantly done the whole way to the end, like where he swung the chair and he finally like did a heel thing. And then to come out, like Mark said, in NWO black and white, like that popped the hell out of me.
Yeah.
You know, to see Cena, you know, finally do the unthinkable and like swing that chair 6 years ago when he could have, which is what the fans just wanted. They wanted, and instead he chose like, and then the WWE, whatever, chose the status quo to keep him, you know, keep him what he was, even keel. Just absolutely brilliant. And again, you said it earlier, if Jeremy Borash had any part of this, Jeremy Borash has like paid back whatever the WWE has paid him double, triple time already. Like his value is these two matches. I know he was involved in the Taker match, which was just, again, brilliantly done. This was so different than that. I'm still not sure, like, the night I saw it, I was like, God, do I love that or did I hate that? Like, I don't know what I saw. I watched it three times since, and I absolutely love that.
Yeah, I'm still not totally sure what I saw. I know I loved it. I'm still not totally sure what I saw with a Boneyard match, and I'm still not even totally sure what a Boneyard match is. But I know I loved it. You know, kudos to everyone involved for putting those two together. All right, let's talk about Drew and Lesnar, but kind of all together, the two like title matches, because I think both title matches pretty similar over the two nights. You had two guys in each match that basically just did their finishers for a total of 6 minutes and 45 seconds, where your two men's world title matches at WrestleMania. Braun Strowman defeated Goldberg in 2:10. Drew McIntyre defeated Brock Lesnar in 4:35. I think that both of those matches would have been about the same if we were in the big stadium in Tampa. The Goldberg match might have even been shorter because I think it would have just been, you know, Goldberg hits a spear, Reigns pops up, hits a spear, and then hits the Superman punch, and then we go. I think the Drew and Lesnar match was booked 100% the way that it would have been booked in the big stadium in Tampa. There is no person on the WWE roster that I feel worse for this weekend than the man who beat Brock Lesnar for the WWE Championship. This moment was meant to happen in front of a stadium full of like 70,000, or if the WWE announced it, 97,000. The culmination of Drew's leaving WWE, creating the name for himself, you know, outside of the WWE, coming back, the journey through NXT, Royal Rumble, eliminating Brock Lesnar, you know, eliminating Roman Reigns to win the Rumble, you know, all the stuff in the build to this match, and then to win it in an empty building when you're you know, standing on top of the top rope and your arms practically hitting the roof of the warehouse performance center because you're in an empty building and there's no crowd there. Obviously, Drew McIntyre totally deserving of this spot and winning the title and all that. But man, I legit, and maybe it's because I also watched like the documentary thing, and you could see how pissed he was the way all of this stuff kind of went down. Obviously, there was nothing that any of us could do to stop it. But like you could just tell just how frustrated and disappointed that he is over this whole situation, and I legit just felt terrible for Drew McIntyre when that bell rang. Ryan, your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, my quick thoughts really are I don't need to see WWE or Universal Championship matches that are like this anymore. I'm over the two big guys, five, six, seven finishers, and then one finally does it. I'm over those style of matches. I don't need to see them again for a long, long time. I definitely feel bad for Drew McIntyre. Here's a guy who's taken his finish, the Claymore kick that we've seen now since he's come back, NXT and above, and turned it into like a fan interaction, the 1-2-3 and the Claymore kick for this moment at WrestleMania, that you can have an entire football arena, a football stadium chanting with you 1-2-3 kick Brock Lesnar, beat him at WrestleMania, and then pyro and just crazy shit going off. And that's the end scene of WrestleMania. I am gutted for Drew McIntyre. Yeah. And I hope he gets that moment somewhere else.
Yeah. Yeah. I think gutted is such a way to put like it. This is the moment that, cause like, here's the thing. I love Brock Lesnar. I still love Brock Lesnar. I don't need to see Brock with a title. I will, like, I'm not going to be in the camp that's going to like hate it if he ever gets one again, but I don't ever need to see it again. But I love Brock Lesnar, and I was like, I was so happy because like at the Royal Rumble, I'm like, oh, Drew's winning the belt at WrestleMania. Like, he's finally the one. This, like, from the time Lesnar beat The Undertaker at WrestleMania 30, basically the whole length of time we've been on the air, he's never really like put anybody over like this, and the whole way to the, and it's just, man, this, yeah, gutted is the perfect word, Ryan. Gutted is the perfect word. This was the moment for like wrestling fans to not shit on the end of WrestleMania, right, wrong, or indifferent, and we didn't get that chance. Matt, your thoughts on this or both title matches?
I mean, I'm with Ryan here. I don't need to see any more matches where it's just finisher. I've been over those matches since we saw The Rock versus Cena one time in a million for the third time, where it was just rock bottom, attitude adjustment, people's elbow, STF for like 16 minutes. So please, WWE, let's cut it out. In terms of Drew McIntyre missing out on his moment, like, I feel for the guy too. You know, he you know, the one of the surviving members of the three-man band finally getting that title. Sorry, Heath Slater. And just not getting to really enjoy that moment like he should have. It sucks for him. So I do hope that we get to see him get that moment down the road. But to be fair, I mean, I don't think that match would have been memorable anyway. Even if there was the crowd, there would have been some interaction and definitely some cheers, but it still would have been just a boring match as a fan to watch.
Yeah. Intern Mark.
Yeah, I agree with Matt. It was, the match was boring, a typical Lesnar match, but I was so happy to see McIntyre take the title, but same thing in the empty arena. Just wasn't the same. It really took away from his moment, which is a shame, but what are you going to do?
Right. Yeah. And here's the thing, like, I obviously it would not shock me if Goldberg or Lesnar, one of those two, or that type ends up with the title again. But if you look at like the majority of the roster and the way that NXT's developed, and if you look at every competitor that was on this show, I think it was almost like a 50-50 split of people that have come through NXT. So if there's any positive sign in terms of like getting away from those type of title matches, I think we're on the safer side, of history, that there's a pretty good chance that we're not going to kind of get those situations anymore, because the guys that are starting to rise up, and get towards the top of the roster, are no longer from, you know, the Ruthless Aggression and, you know, subsequent years. Like, we're kind of at the point where like wrestling has worked its way back into the entertainment. So I think there's a better than not chance that those days are kind of behind us in terms of those type of title matches. So let's as we begin to start to kind of wrap the weekend up, as you will, let's give a letter grade for WrestleMania this year. We will start with you, Ryan. What is your letter grade for WrestleMania 36?
WrestleMania 36, no doubt a historic WrestleMania that will go down in history. We're all going to look back at this time and hopefully look at it fondly, that we did what we had to do in social distancing and this and that, and it might have sucked, but the WWE did what they could, and for that, I will give them a B.
All right. Matt, what letter grade do you give WrestleMania 36?
Yeah, I mean, there was some really good stuff, some really not so good stuff. So basically, what we would come to expect out of a WrestleMania, and for the most part, I tend to grade WrestleMania's a little harder because it's supposed to be the greatest. This time it was absolutely different. And so I'm going to give it a solid B plus, just because it was something that we desperately needed, and I think they did a great job with it.
Awesome. Intern Mark, what grade do you give WrestleMania 36?
I would go ahead and give WrestleMania 36 a B plus as well. I thought about it, and I tried to think of the matches, what it'd be like if it was in the arena, if I would still be give it the same grade, and I think I would have. But I think overall it was very entertaining, and I enjoyed it more so than some other years. So I'm going to give it a solid B plus.
Awesome. So I kind of put it out, not as a official,
the three count question of the week.
But I did put it out today on our Facebook and Twitter. Devin gives this one an A. Chris said I'd give it a C. He said it seemed like more thought was put into night one than night two. Especially when it came out to the Firefly Funhouse match. It looked more like one of those bad 70 horror B movies you can catch on a broadcast channel at 1 in the morning. Nick says, you know all my gripes. We all know you are going to give it an A, speaking directly at me. But he said a solid B. And Zach says, kind of a bad vibe with no fans. He says he did like the show, but gives it a C-. I'm absolutely giving this show an A. I probably have already said it on social media before. And the reason is this. Was it a perfect show? No. Was there stuff that I did not like on the show? Absolutely. But again, and the thing that I will talk about in the short term and in the long term about this period of time is it's kind of its own little time capsule. And like I said earlier in the show, tomorrow will be 3 weeks that I've basically been at my house. I've gone for walks. And yesterday I went to pick up dog food at the vet. Those are the times I've been away from my house for the past 3 weeks. It has been, this Thursday will be a month since we were live on the air and Ryan was here in studio with me. So, you know, this has been a couple of hard weeks. Like if you saw the thing I posted on our site, this has been hard. This has absolutely been one of the hardest like periods of time in my life. The mental part side of it. And for two nights, for 3 hours each night, I completely forgot about everything that was going on. And I watched WrestleMania, and to me there is no more valuable thing in this world than being able to be entertained and to put away the problems of the world, whether it's the current problems or just in general. So to me, absolutely this show gets an A from me because of what it did for me for the two nights that it was on. 100% without question. It was what I needed. It's what a lot of us needed. And they delivered like only the WWE can at this point, because everything else is shut down. So before we wrap it up, last night on Raw, and overall, I thought the Raw show wasn't bad. I mean, we got more matches, like current matches, than we've gotten since they've gone to the Performance Center. There was some good, there was some meh. And they kept talking about we're going to find out what happened after WrestleMania. And they take us to after WrestleMania, and the Big Show's music hits, and immediately, like, all the good that I had felt for like 2 days in terms of wrestling, like, just sank to the pit of my stomach. And I'm like, there is no way that they're going to do this, is there? Like, and then as it's the moment started to play out, I'm going, oh my God, the Big Show is about to win the WWE Championship from Drew McIntyre. Not a day after he wins it, 27 minutes or whatever they told us it was after he wins it. And thank God they didn't do it. But that closing segment from last night's Raw was just awful. It was just awful. They didn't have to do that. They could have done anything to close out the Mania weekend. And they chose that. That was a bad choice. And like, it just, no, I hated it. I absolutely hated it. Ryan, your thoughts on the close of the Raw after Mania?
I didn't care for much of the Raw after Mania. Cool to see Bianca Belair finally get a call up. That's awesome. She's going to be an absolute star on that brand. Apollo Crews is on Raw. I didn't know he wasn't on Raw. So, like, when his music hit, I was like, all right, this should be a decent match. Apollo Crews can go. And then they were like, oh, this is a draft choice. And I'm like, oh, I didn't know he wasn't there.
Yeah, I honestly didn't remember.
No freaking clue. Nia Jax coming back, whatever. Her five moves of doom.
That's a huge bitch.
That's not far off. There's no need to ever, I don't need to see the Big Show wrestle again, man.
No.
I don't need to see it.
I don't.
At all.
No.
I don't give a shit if he has a show on Netflix, if he has a show on the USA Network. I don't give a shit if he has a show on Fox. I don't need to see the Big Show in a WWE ring ever again.
Has anybody watched any of the Big Show show yet?
Absolutely not.
No, I don't have that kind of free time.
Matt, have you watched any of it yet? I know you kind of put it out there about if anybody wants to watch it and do some sort of a review of it. Have you watched an episode yet? Uh-oh, did we lose Matt? Oh, I think we had lost Matt. We definitely lost Matt.
I feel like Matt is far too embarrassed. Once we started talking about the Big Show, he bailed. He's like, nope, I know what they're going to ask. I'm done.
He was out. The embarrassment got him.
Oh, yeah, he did. He messaged a group because I can't talk about this. I'm too embarrassed. I haven't watched the Big Show yet. I will watch it. I think it's clever. I saw a funny tweet and somebody said they should do a making of series about it and call it the Big Show. So I thought that was a clever tweet. Mark, any thoughts on the close of Raw after Mania last night?
Just unnecessary. I don't get it at all. Unless you're just trying to get Big Show a rub for his new show.
I guess. But they didn't even mention it. That's the funniest part, is they didn't even mention the Big Show show. Wait a minute. So why?
Just unnecessary. Completely unnecessary. I don't think, honestly, there's a wrestling fan today that wanted to see the Big Show again.
No.
In a ring. I really don't.
And like,
I
believe there's certain people on the roster that you could have like done that with for Drew to win, like after he beats Brock Lesnar, to have him like look stronger. The Big Show in 2020 is not that guy. So it was just very confusing. Again, I'm so glad that Drew retained. I can't believe I actually had to have to say that he retained, but just WWE, just don't do that again. Just don't do that again.
Yeah, imagine if the Big Show took the title off of Drew. That would drop the whole Mania letter grade, don't you think?
Oh, God. Please. I mean.
Absolutely.
I mean, like, I get things are chaotic, but, like, you have the option to not be chaotic when you're WWE right now. Guys, I appreciate, you know, this has been great. I'm happy to sit down and record. Let's kind of close this thing out. Ryan, go ahead.
Did you see some of the numbers that WWE was pulling in for this WrestleMania though?
I did not.
I mean, financially, this WrestleMania is going to hurt them. I saw somewhere it could be up to a $22 million loss.
Ooh.
Revenue at the stadium for the multiple nights, merch sales. There's a lot that went into that $22 million number.
Oh, sure.
And basing it off of like last year's figures and stuff like that.
I mean, you didn't have access and all the signings and all of the stuff that goes along with that. You didn't have, you didn't have the Hall of Fame, which is a merch grab. And then obviously Mania, you didn't have TakeOver. You didn't have Raw at an arena, the day after. Yeah. I mean, and the city of Tampa too. I mean, obviously, you know, and with everything going on, I mean, cities and municipalities and stuff are taking hits left and right. And for the city of Tampa, you're talking about a big loss there as well.
Right. Not to mention all of the independent shows that have been uprooted and displaced because of this as well. So a bum deal there. But WWE has set WrestleMania week viewership records, more than 967 million video views across the company's digital and social platforms.
Jeez.
Now that's the network, WWE.com, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and Snapchat. Welcome to 2020.
No shit.
That is an increase of 20% over last year.
Wow.
That's a freaking number.
Yeah. And I mean, here's the thing. You know, and one thing I did notice is like this WrestleMania, they did cut to ads between matches, but it's their only revenue for the show. So, you know, and you know, I'm sure that each one of those social media spots, there was probably at least like WrestleMania brought to you by Snickers somewhere on somewhere on it. So, yeah, I mean, they at least had to make up some money somewhere. I mean, yeah, it's without question a tremendous loss for WWE. But wow, those are some unbelievable numbers in terms of the social media hits as well.
46 million hours of content viewed over WrestleMania week.
Jeez.
Percent increase over last year.
How many people? I mean, just the eyes they had on that product this weekend, just phenomenal. Can't even wrap my head around that. It's crazy.
The thing I would really love to know, and I don't know if it'll ever come out or not, is the number of pay-per-view buys you'll be able to find out, but the number of people that bought it through the Fox Sports app and through the Fight app. Those are going to be some interesting, like those are numbers that I'm just curious about. Like I don't know how many people bought it through those services. But they were presented. And here's the thing. I think they were presented not for wrestling fans, per se, because wrestling fans probably already have the network or bought it on the network. I think that's for people that I'm not going to buy the WWE. I'm not going to download the WWE network. I'm not a wrestling fan. But if they're like, hey, there's going to be a live, you know, entertainment event on the Fox Sports. Okay, I'll check it out. You know, Fight TV is more than just wrestling as well. So those are numbers that if they ever come out, I'm genuinely curious about. Because I know people are like, why would you put them on Fight TV? Nobody's going to buy it on there. Well, somebody will. They're not going to go through the trouble of doing that if they didn't know that there was an audience to get it on. Same with the Fox Sports app. Because here's the thing, you can use the same argument, the same, why would somebody spend $50 or $60 on WrestleMania on the Fight app when you have the WWE network? So why is it on pay-per-view? Yeah. Because people are still going to buy it on pay-per-view. So yeah, I'm curious once the dust settles and we find out the numbers, because you probably will at some point, just exactly how many people bought it through those. But yeah, those are some wild numbers, man. Absolutely wild numbers.
And hey, but before we get going, I have a fun little game for you and Mark.
Okay.
Now this is 12 of the 19 people who win their matches last year at WrestleMania did not appear at this year's WrestleMania. Can you name them?
So 12 of the people, you said 12 of the people that won matches at Mania last year were not on this Mania.
Correct. 12 of the 19 people to win matches last year were not on this year's card. People dividing tag teams up. So a tag team would be two people.
Okay. Ronda Rousey. Oh, no, Ronda didn't win last year. Ryder, Ryder and Hawkins?
Yeah, Ryder and Hawkins for sure.
I'm going to try and do this without like cheating and looking at last year's card. Shane McMahon.
Shane McMahon is one of them.
The Miz. No, Miz lost.
Yeah, Miz lost. Kofi was
there. Tony Nese. Did he win last year?
Tony Nese is one of them.
Aha. Uh-huh. Well done, Mark. Trying to think. Seth was there.
Women's tag.
The two Iconics, yeah.
The Iconics.
So that's what, five?
That is six.
Halfway home.
Let's see. Strowman won the Battle Royal last year, and he was there this year.
Let's see who. Who? All right. Who won the Intercontinental title? Or
didn't Carmella win the women's match? Women's
Aha!
Battle Royal?
Well done, Mark. Man, this is tough. How, like, you know, you would think it'd be easier to remember year to year.
I got almost all of them. I will wrap up for you guys. Roman Reigns.
Oh, duh.
Roman Reigns, of course.
Oh, Triple H beat Batista.
Triple H, there we go.
Was the Balor, Finn Balor.
Finn Balor, yep, you've got two left.
Let's see. Kofi was there. He won.
AJ was there.
Mm-hmm.
Think of that big guy from California.
Oh, Joey Samoa.
Joey Samoa.
Is that it?
And Mark, that's one more, and this one's tough. I mean, it's on a technicality. The last one that didn't appear but won their match last year would be Jey Uso, because Jimmy wrestled.
Okay.
Uso.
Fair. That's fair.
But, only seven people that were victorious last year even wrestled in a match this year. Wild number to think
crazy.
About.
Crazy.
Yeah, it really is.
All right, Ryan.
And were there last year, Smokey.
We were there.
And that was
one year ago today,
you were not even halfway through WrestleMania.
We were just settling into our seats at this time.
Yeah.
Yes, we were.
Ryan, any closing thoughts here as we close this thing out?
No, just thank you to the WWE for allowing me to forget about life for a while. So sing us a song, Piano Man. Sing us a song.
That's what I was thinking when you said that.
I had a really, really good time. I'm thankful that they did it. I'm thankful that we can get together and do things like this still. You know, in the days and ages of social distancing, it's weird to see Fallon at home. It's weird to see these artists performing concerts in their living rooms and shit. So if we can get some content out to the listeners of Three Count Thursday, we're going to try to do it as much as we can.
Yeah.
You know, to try to record, you know, small videos, something like that, just to get some content up on Facebook. If anybody ever wants to record anything from us, like, just let us know. We'll try to get something up for you guys. But thank you to the people that have, like, stuck by us and have messaged us and, like, checked if we were okay, things like that. It really goes a long, long way. We do have some awesome followers and some awesome fans. So
yeah, no doubt.
That's it. Like I said in my piece, everybody stay safe, keep a distance, stay the hell away from me, and let's get over this together.
Yeah, no doubt. Intern Mark, anything to add?
Yeah, I'll tell you what. I was really kind of, you know, thinking maybe they ought to postpone WrestleMania, not necessarily cancel it. But I'll tell you what, I'm very glad they went through with it. I very, very much enjoyed the show. It was a great distraction, like we talked about earlier. I think it's exactly what we needed. No, not just as wrestling fans, but yeah, there were so many people as the numbers show that watched it who were probably just looking for something different, live entertainment. And yeah, like once again, like we talked about earlier, it takes your mind off what's going on in the world. And that's what more could you ask for right now? I mean, I think it was a great distraction, much needed.
Yeah, yeah, and I echo that as well. You know, if you look at our social media pages, what I posted Sunday night was, again, just a thank you to WWE, because it was, for some of us, it was needed more than for others, but we all needed it. I'm one of those people who needed it more. And as WWE has been there for us and for me our entire lives, it again was there when we needed them the most. I can't thank WWE enough, and I can't thank our fans and our listeners and, yeah, the people who have reached out to us just to see how we're doing. We're still here. It's a little different, but we're going to get through this thing. And again, you hear it everywhere you go, but stay home unless you absolutely have to go out. Stay home, stay distant from people. If you don't live with them, don't go see him right now. That's the rule. Like, that is the rule. And wash your damn hands. And we will talk to you whenever we talk to you again. Keep enjoying it. And I say this every time, stay safe, people. We love you and thank you. And we're signing off.